In that spirit, what's your take on the financial censorship that the Canadian truckers faced with their bank accounts getting shut down and stuff? Do you think that highlights what Bitcoin's really important for?
I think it woke a lot of people up. Yeah, I think a lot of people, Bitcoiners as well as just an everyday normal people, saw the value of a censorship resistant form of money. The Canadian truckers got stung. The way that they got their donations paid out was really silly, but that's how it went down. And I think, just judging from the amount of people that have been installing Samurai Wallet and entering Whirlpool, I think something definitely shifted, something changed, and woke some people up. Yeah.
Yeah, it's been interesting to see how the distribution of funds actually happened. Seemingly not that well. I think one of the guys got arrested as well, and essentially gave away.
One of the organizers got a visit from the some Canadian police force with a search warrant, I suppose. So they searched his place, and he says that they took the keys with them. So he says that the keys are no longer in his control, and they're in the control of this Canadian police agency or whatever. We'll see if that's true or not, based on the activity that what happens with those coins, right? If those coins that are supposedly in control of whatever Canadian police end up going to crypto.com, it's likely that they're not in control. Someone else is in control. So, I mean, the blockchain is there. We have our eye on the distribution because it's just interesting. The way that they chose to distribute these funds was silly. And then they videotaped themselves doing it at a time when it became unlawful to do so for these particular funds. That was a big mistake.
On that note, so I would just read a text from an article that says, jumping off from the CoinFirm analysis, blockchain analytics company Chainlysis saw that the presumed attacker had sent 50 BTC to Wasabi Wallet, private desktop. And basically, he used Wasabi and he was caught. Now, I think this was the...
This is the DAO hacker you're talking about, right?
Yeah. So my question is, if that was, he was using Samurai Dojo, basically going through you guys, would it still be the same end result?
Well, not in the way that they were able to figure it out with Wasabi. No, it wouldn't be possible. It wouldn't be possible on either Whirlpool or Join Market. It's only possible on Wasabi. So we looked into this. So this is the DAO hacker you're talking about. And what this guy did was use Shapeshift, I believe, to convert into Bitcoin. So we knew the Shapeshift TX IDs of the, we'll call them the illicit coins, right? They entered, as you said, it's actually a little bit more than 50. I think they did 75 into Wasabi. There were just two transactions. But let's talk about the 50 Bitcoin transaction and what happened here. So they put 50 Bitcoins into Wasabi. Now, one of the things we've been talking about nonstop is the fact that unmixed change is a part of every single Wasabi mixed transaction. So in every mixed transaction, there is a portion of that transaction that has not been mixed that can still be linked to the person who deposited it in, okay? The 50 Bitcoin hacker mixed, I think it was initially 6 Bitcoin. The rest of it, so 40 something Bitcoin, could still be tracked to that user. This is how Wasabi works. By the fourth mix, unfortunately, the unmixed output of, it was at that point something like 30 Bitcoin, was sent to an address that had been sent a mixed output. So there was address reuse, where you had one output on the address was a mixed coin, and then the other output on the address was this unmixed change that follows along. So because that address reuse happened, it's not the user who did it, it's the client, the wallet software that did it. Shouldn't have happened, but we've been saying this has been happening since 2019. So it happened again. Because that happened, the next time they spent, they only spent 6 mixed transactions. So a total of 1 Bitcoin out of the 50 Bitcoin that they put in, they sent that to Poloniex. But because of the address reuse, we knew that that 1 Bitcoin that they sent out from the mixer was connected to the 50 Bitcoin that went in from the DAO hacker. So that address reuse is what got them screwed up. It's not possible to do that in Whirlpool. One, because the unmixed change is never a part of the mix, ever. The unmixed change goes to a completely separate account in the wallet, a completely separate derivation path. So it's not possible for the wallet to ever make a transaction that combines those outputs. And in joint market, it's the same. They use a separate derivation path. So again, you can't link these outputs together because one of them is not mixed and one of them is mixed, and they got both sent to the same address. That's what did it. So on our YouTube, I put a 5-minute video on my YouTube channel that shows exactly how you can do it yourself using free tools, how to track the wallet of the 50 Bitcoin as it goes through Wasabi. And you see that address you use, and it opens up the whole window. So no, it wouldn't be possible in Whirlpool. It wouldn't be possible in Joy Market. It's only possible in Wasabi. And it's exactly what we've been saying since 2019, that this is a big issue because this could happen. And that's exactly what happened this time.
It's kind of weird because this is an issue for Wasabi. And as it seems like you pointed out, that it's something that's obviously like a flaw. Wouldn't it be better if they just fix it and, you know, it does well for their business? I mean, why would they be, you know, ignoring something that could potentially, you know, harm their business? It feels, you know, a little odd to me, you know, don't you think?
Yeah, I don't understand it at all. Look, we got a report. Someone reached out to us and said, hey, I've been looking at the blockchain and I see 5,000 occurrences of address reuse from post-mix spends in Samurai, right? That's what they said to us. So not in the mix, because it's impossible for address reuse in the mix, but they were seeing post-mix spends, so transactions that were occurring after mixing, having a large amount of address reuse. That's what they reported to us. We spent a month researching this. We spent a month investigating. We looked up on the blockchain every single post-mix transaction that had come from Whirlpool that had ever at that point, and analyzed each one to see the address reuse impact. Now, fortunately, that initial 5,000 claim was wrong. There was a lot of false positives there. The actual number was something like 200, which is very low, but we still took that 200 very seriously. And we broke it down even further and said, okay, out of that 200, how many of those were the result of them, the user, doing something to reuse addresses versus the client screwing up, the wallet software screwing up and reusing addresses? It was something like 100 was what we would say was our fault, right? 100 of these post-mix transactions had some form of address reuse that the user had no control over. So it was our fault that happened. Nowhere close to the 5,000, but still a problem in our view. So we fixed it. We figured out a way that we could stop that from occurring, and we rolled that out. That is how you respond to someone saying, hey, something's wrong with your software, right? And that's what we would expect Wasabi to do, is research it themselves. Not take what we're saying at face value and go, okay, yeah, absolutely. No, look at it yourself. Because that's exactly what we did, right? We got a report that said 5,000 address reuses. Okay, we found that it was actually 100, but still, of that 100, we did something about it. We made the software better for users. Why they haven't acknowledged it, I have no idea. I don't even speculate on it. It's what frustrates me so much, is that it's, again, right there. Anyone can verify it. It's just the blockchain, but very few people do that.
Does Samurai have any... I know you guys are like super innovative with Ricochet and Stonewall and a bunch of features that other wallets don't have. Do you guys have any new features that you're planning on implementing?
Yeah, you know, there's a couple things that are in our pipeline. One thing we want to do is introduce something called multi-party TX0. So the TX0 is, you can think of it as a setup transaction before entering Whirlpool CoinJoin. So every user that enters Whirlpool CoinJoin, they have this transaction, the TX0, where they pay the CoinJoin fee, and their Bitcoin is split up into identical size amounts. Currently, anyone watching the blockchain knows that one TX0 is one entity, right? It can only be one entity involved in that TX0 transaction. What we want to do is create multi-party TX0, so you could have multiple entities in one TX0 transaction, and that would undermine the heuristic that one person is in control of this amount of Bitcoin going into Whirlpool, right? So if I want to mix a Bitcoin, you want to mix a Bitcoin, that TX0 transaction would take your Bitcoin and my Bitcoin in this one, you know, one transaction. So that's something that is going to improve things for users. We're working on something kind of big, but we're not talking about exactly what it is. But we've been working on that most of last year and a little bit of this year. We're hoping by April we'll be able to talk about it though.
Something that I wish I'd asked Wasabi, but how do you guys monetize your wallet? Like, how are you guys bringing in income? Is it that you raised funding and then have used that to create this, or what is it that you guys are doing to bring in income? And I've seen, obviously, you have different products, and there's things like the node you can buy. So obviously those things would bring in some, but what's like the main income source?
So actually we don't make any money from the nodes. That's a completely separate team. they just use the Dojo software that we created. But the way that we've monetized, and no, it hasn't been through investment. It's been through our assumption early on that users would be willing to pay a fee to gain transactional privacy on the blockchain. So we have a Whirlpool fee, a coordinator fee. This serves two purposes. The primary purpose of the coordinator fee is to prevent Sybil attacks. So if the coordinator is free, then you can just for free with no limit, just stuff the coordinator either with junk to bring it down or try to become, you know, four of the inputs in a five person mix. So you have a coordinator fee to reduce that, but also helps pay for the servers and the people working on stuff. We've also had Ricochet in the wallet, which is a type of transaction that adds five hops of history before your coins arrive at their destination. So let's say you're sending to a centralized exchange and you don't know whether they're going to like the fact that you used CoinJoin. You could make that a Ricochet transaction for a small extra fee. And it will create five transactions before hitting the exchange. So if the exchange is looking back for five hops, they're not seeing anything that, you know, they wouldn't like. And that's been in the wallet since 2016. People have been using that for many years, and it seems to work well for them. Those are the two primary ways, though.
Gotcha, thanks. That's cool. It provides more clarity on that one because. Yeah, I'd assume there's some kind of fee or something, but I just wasn't entirely certain. Like, I've never used Samurai myself, so yeah. I wasn't entirely certain on that one. Appreciate it.
Yeah, you know, the coordinator fee, it can be very low. You know, the lowest fee is 5,000 Satoshis for entering into the 100,000 Satoshi pool. So, you know, it's you can put any amount into the mixer and pay a flat fee. And you can get remixes for free as well. So you don't pay miner fee or coordinator fee for additional mixes that you're involved in.
Yeah, I'm a big, you know, Samurai user. I think I'm probably one of like the only, not only, but, you know, the guy who only uses from Nigeria who uses Samurai. I was pretty pissed when you guys removed the, you know, USD, you know, value. Uh-huh. Yeah, I was really angry. I was like, what the hell, man? Like, I know you guys mentioned that, you know, you wanted to de-tiatify, you know, people, but come on, man, like, you know.
That was so you've been using it a long time. That was 2018, I think, is when we got rid of that. So you know, I think it was the right move. One, we had it was a big support burden. You know, at the time there was a lot of new users coming into Bitcoin, and you would not believe the number of support emails we got from people saying, you know, I had $1, I had $10 yesterday, and now I have, you know, $8. Why did you steal from me? You know, send it back. I mean, seriously, it was a lot of people. And it was just kind of shocking to us that this concept was foreign to all the Bitcoin users that we're entering now. So we said, well, what's the best way to teach them that they have no dollars when they're dealing with Bitcoin? And we got rid of it. We yanked it out and replaced it with Satoshis. And Satoshis became popular. A lot of wallets do that now with displaying the Satoshi value. But yeah, in Samurai Wallet, you know, it relies on the merchant to set the exchange rate, right? So another big issue that we had when we had fiat values in the wallet was your wallet would be pulling from, let's say, Bitstamp, and then your buddy's wallet would be pulling from, you know, Coinbase, the price, and the price is different. There's not one uniform Bitcoin price. There's multiple different prices out there. And that could cause issues with exchanges and such. So yeah, we got rid of it, and I'm happy we did. I think it's better without it. And most users get used to it or, you know, don't even notice it at this point. We kept fiat values in Sentinel, which is our watch-only wallet app. And that will make more sense because upcoming update to that app, you're able to compose offline transactions and then sign it with your, you know, whatever hardware wallet or your Samurai wallet or something else. So this is the app that you can transact from. And when you're transacting, the fiat value makes a little sense there, and receiving as the merchant. So a lot of Sentinel users are the merchant. They're selling a t-shirt for Bitcoin. It makes sense for them to set what the exchange rate is, not the person sending the Bitcoin. You know, for example, when you buy a gift card on Bitrefill, you don't tell Bitrefill what the rate is that you're going to be paying at. Bitrefill tells you. They say, hey, this is the rate that you have to pay. So it's up to the merchant, not the wallet. And that's kind of where we landed with it.
My last question is there ever going to be a desktop version of Samurai?
We would love to have a desktop wallet. We would love to have an iOS wallet. We would love to have all this stuff. But the team is still so small that we don't have a huge amount of resources to develop the desktop or iOS or anything like that. So we're going to focus on mobile still, and maybe sometime in the future we'll have more resources and we can do it properly and do it right.
My last question. You did mention that you know there's no intention to support Lightning because adoption is low and basically you do not see any real benefits. I think most people will disagree, you know, that, you know, they think they see the benefits of Lightning, you know, super low fees, some privacy, you know, privacy benefits. And I find it odd, you know, for you to be a big, you know, Bitcoin and, you know, privacy proponent, it kind of seems like you do not believe in Lightning.
No, I don't believe in Lightning at all. I think it was completely shoehorned in as the quote unquote scaling solution at a time where there was a perceived crisis in terms of block space. You know, during the fork wars, and right before the fork wars, there was a huge spam attack on the network. The network was being the blockchain was being clogged with transactions that were not true economic transactions. That was an actual spam attack, and the intent of that spam attack was to raise the miner fee. So in a response to that, people, you know, developers, core developers particularly, had this desire to come up with the scaling solution. And I think that Lightning was a option, And I don't think it was is the best option, but it's gone so far now that it's in people's minds the only option. And there's plenty of other things out there in terms of scaling. It could be drive chains, it could be side chains, it could be a whole different type of network. I think what we've seen with Lightning now, that we've had years of it being developed and pushed, is that there is an overwhelming tendency to provide custodial solutions on top of Lightning, because dealing with Lightning in a non-custodial way is a nightmare. Okay, the user has to balance channels, they have to, you know, make these backups, because if their node goes down, so does their funds. I mean, all of this stuff that makes it inhospitable for non-custodial use. You're not going to get a large amount of non-custodial use here. And we see that with all the most popular Lightning wallets being custodial wallets. And we see a centralizing, you know, factor there. And the privacy benefits of Lightning are very overstated if you're dealing with a centralized network. So no, we don't. And I believe, you know, Sergey posts every year the uptick that Bitrefill is having from Lightning users. And it's virtually none. I think Ethereum gets more use than Lightning on Bitrefill. So, I mean, I don't see how anyone can disagree with the fact that adoption has not been taken off. People aren't using it in that way. And the people that are using it, it's a very small community. It's a niche thing. Maybe it will change. But even so, I think it's going to go in the direction of custody. And when you go the direction of custody, KYC shortly follows. So our goal is, and our focus is on the main chain. We have no issue or, you know, beef with anyone that works on Lightning. I think that's great. Developers should work on what they want to work on. And especially the developers who are focusing on non-custody. I think that, you know, they're doing great work and should continue doing so. But our focus is on the main chain because, you know, it's still being used considerably more than Lightning or anything else.
But yeah, you did mention that, you know, that Lightning was a response to this, you know, the issue of scaling, but scaling is still a problem, at least down the road, you know, down the road is still a problem. So what you did mention, you know, sidechains, do you have, you know, any specific, you know, scaling solution that, you know, you are kind of, you know, anticipating or, you know, that sort of thing?
There's not any particular solution that I'm excited about or anticipating or anything like that. I think, obviously, in the future, scaling on second and third layers is going to be required for Bitcoin. Everyone who's involved in Bitcoin, especially in the early days, knows this. But the reality of the situation is, for the most part, consistently, blocks are clearing at one sat per byte. Right? Users want their transaction in the next block, they're going in at one sat per byte and they can get it done. You know, there's spikes here and there, but miner fees have not gone up. Block space competition is not a problem. And we're in 2022 at the height of an adoption curve. Those people didn't go into Lightning. They went in to other blockchains. They went into Ethereum. They went into Solana. They went into all these other things. So Bitcoin's second layer has been Ethereum. That's how it's played out in the actual market. You know, that's going to be a problem for Bitcoin when that block subsidy is gone. So that's going to need this. That needs to be figured out. But that's the reality of the situation. And I think it's largely due to, again, a malinvestment of time and resources in Lightning too early. That's just my hypothesis on it. We'll see how things play out.
Future will tell us the answer to what happens, I suppose. We're over an hour now, so it's probably a good time to wrap up. And it's been awesome to have you on and get a good understanding of a better understanding of Samurai Wallet and a better understanding of the history of it and where like the Wasabi split happened and things like that. So it's really been quite useful to have you. So I appreciate that. Is there any sort of final words you'd like to say or any sort of plugs you'd like to give before we head out?
Well, I just want to say thanks for having me. I've been a big Bitrefill user since 2012. I met the team over in Stockholm around that time, Sergey and everyone. I think there was only two or three other people, but it's been a great company and a useful tool for everyone. So I just want to say thank you to Bitrefill for that. As for my own plugs, just I think, you know, there's a general go to our website and go to our Twitter and all that crap, but go to YouTube and search for Samourai Wallet and check out the privacy series that I had brought up before in our conversation. It will take less than 45 minutes to watch all 7 videos, and you'll come away with a really good understanding of how your privacy can be undermined on the blockchain and how you can defend against that kind of undermining. So Samourai Wallet on YouTube, and check that out.
Awesome. Well, you heard it here. Go check it out. And I saw the video series that you guys are creating. I started watching one video, then got sidetracked going to get dinner and haven't finished it, but I'm going to watch the whole series myself. So yeah, thanks for creating content like that. Thank you for doing what you're doing. And thanks to all of our listeners for listening in. It's much appreciated. We hope you have an amazing day, week, month, year. Keep loving life, keep being happy, and keep buying Bitcoin. See you soon.